السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله I will commence with a short recitation from the Quran for purposes of barakah, إن شاء الله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يسألونك عن الأنفال قل الأنفال لله والرسول فاتقوا الله وأصلحوا ذات بينكم فاتقوا الله وأصلحوا ذات بينكم وأطيعوا الله ورسوله بعدما تبين يجادلونك في الحق بعدما تبين كأنما يساقون إلى الموت وهم ينظرون. صدق الله العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, and curer of one and all. Notice the word Rabb. Rabb is an Arabic word which does not have a simple translation, rather it includes all the words that I've just mentioned. وأصلي وأسلم على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا وإمامنا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Complete blessings and salutations be upon the masterpiece Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. And bless all those who have struggled and strived to bring this deen and this religion to us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us, all of us who are seated here this evening, as well as the entire Muslim ummah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us offspring who will be the coolness of our eyes and bless them as well up to the day of Qiyamah. Ameen. My dearest brothers and sisters in Islam, really I am very honored to be speaking here this evening, and I make a dua at the beginning of this particular lecture where I say, Allahumma la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. O Allah, we do not have knowledge besides that which you have granted us, for definitely you are the owner of knowledge, the owner of wisdom. Allahumma 'allimna ma yanfa'na wa anfa'na bima 'allamtana. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن عين لا تدمع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن بطن لا يشبع ومن دعاء لا يسمع. O Allah, grant us knowledge that will be beneficial, knowledge that will be put to use, and protect us from knowledge that we do not make use of. And Ya Allah, protect us from eyes that will not cry for your sake, from a heart that will not tremble, in fear of you, from a stomach that will never be filled, from a soul that will never be content, and from a dua that we make to you that is not responded. This evening we are speaking of Surah Al-Fatiha, inshallah. Before I commence, I need to highlight that it is known as Al-Fatiha, meaning the opening surah of this Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to commence this Quran with a surah. It is absolutely important to know that just that fact itself already proves to us the virtue of this particular surah. And every single one of us, if we are to read Surah Al-Fatiha, and I will read it before you just now, understanding it, it will be totally different than if we were to read it without understanding it. So many of us know that Surah Al-Fatiha is a surah that we need to read in salah. We know that this is one of the first surahs that a revert to Islam would need to learn. And we know so much about Surah Al-Fatiha, even in our sleep, we would be able to correct someone whom we do not share the same language with. What do I mean when I say we do not share the same language with? It means if you were to go to China today, how many of you speak Chinese? You might know a word, ni hao, or something like that. But that doesn't mean you speak the language, just like myself. You might know a word or two, but you cannot meaningfully speak it unless you were Chinese or you learned it. I don't know, there might be some sisters who may be putting up their hands, I can't see them. So the reality is, if you were to arrive in a masjid in China and you heard the Imam saying, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alamun, what would you say? Do you know Chinese? Can you tell him, hi, how are you, outside salah? You can't. You don't even know how to communicate to him. You don't know how to ask him, what's your name? But you know, if he says alamun, you will say alameen. That's something you can correct, inshallah. That's the power of the surah. You know it off by heart. Let me tell you, it's amazing. Sometimes I've been asked questions by non-Muslims who say, why do we have to learn the Quran in Arabic? Why? What's the reason? Why do I have to learn the Quran in the Arabic language? There are many answers that are given. One of them is, for you to contribute towards the protection of this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Definitely, we are the ones who have revealed this book, the Quran, and we will protect it and ensure that it remains intact. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a plan to keep this Quran intact. Part of the plan is, those who don't know the Arabic language will memorize it. Amazing. Or at least memorize parts of it. Why? Their salah, their prayer will not be complete until and unless they read portions of the Quran exactly as they were revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Without that, their salah won't be complete. So, you find a revert to Islam, one of the first things after Tahara and so on they are learning is how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. I know, transliterated, there are a lot of people who have reverted to Islam in my presence, who have then learned Surah Al-Fatiha. So they know the surah, firstly, without even knowing the meaning. So, that is your contribution, my contribution towards the protection of the Quran, firstly, even without understanding it. So remember, how were the other scriptures lost? The other scriptures that are in existence, the original manuscripts, how have they disappeared? They have disappeared because their followers decided that we will adjust the word of God for us to understand it. So as time passed and they translated it into several languages, they lost the original. When it comes to the Quran, the Muslims are totally different. We will adjust ourselves to understand the word of God, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the difference. They adjusted the word of God for them to understand it. In the process, they lost it. With us, we will adjust ourselves to understand, to read the Quran, to memorize it and to understand it, so it will remain and it has remained intact. Alhamdulillah. We thank Allah for that. And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a hadith, which was narrated to us through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, يُقَالُ لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ اِقْرَأْ وَارْتَقِي وَرَتِّلْ كَمَا كُنْتَ تُرَتِّلُ فِي الدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّ مَنْزِلَتَكَ عِنْدَ آخِرِ آيَةٍ تَقْرَأُهَا. On the day of Qiyamah, صاحب القرآن, a person with the Qur'an, that's the meaning of صاحب القرآن, a person with the Qur'an, will be told, read and recite as though you used to recite in the dunya, or recite in the same manner you used to recite in the dunya, and keep on going up as you are reciting. Your final abode in heaven shall be at the point where you stop, where you get stuck, or where you don't know any further. What is the meaning of Sahih al-Quran? The majority of the scholars of hadith say it is a person who has memorized the entire Quran. But I'd like to take the other meaning of it, to include all of us here. We have all got, every single one of us, have got a portion of the Quran in our hearts. Is that not correct? Off by heart. I'm sure we all memorize Surah Al-Fatiha. We all probably know Surah Al-Ikhlas. We all probably know Surah Al-Kawthar. Inna a'tainaka al-Kawthar. So, wouldn't we, inshallah, also be told to recite? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us acceptance. So, these are just some of the issues surrounding the memorization of Surah Al-Fatiha, the memorization of the Qur'an, and how important it is to know the Surah off by heart.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط
Amazing. If I were to read the same surah slightly differently, you would actually pick up and say, you know what, this is the tune of Sudais. You would say, this is the tune of Shurayn. This is the tune of so-and-so. Obviously, these are names that you know and I know. That's why I'm taking them. But that is the power of the surah. It is read in the opening of Salah. So what does it mean? Because most of us, to be honest, even if we do know the literal meaning of it, we tend to read Surah Al-Fatiha without concentrating on its meaning in Salah. And for that reason, I wish to share with you a powerful hadith, one of the most powerful ahadith connected to this particular surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a hadith, Qudsi. Do you know what is the meaning of hadith Qudsi? Qudsi means, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, and then quote, and he quotes the saying, unquote, and he completes the saying, but it's not part of the Quran. That's the meaning of hadith Qudsi. Which means there is a hadith, it's not part of the Quran, but there is a quotation from the sayings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not just from the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he is narrating what the Creator Jalla Sha'nuhu has said. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ. I have divided as-salah between myself and my worshipper into two portions, two equal portions. One might ask, what is the meaning of the term as-salah? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I have divided salah between myself and my worshipper into two equal portions. So, in order to understand what is meant by the term as-salah, we would need to read the rest of the hadith. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ قُلْتُ حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي. Subhanallah. He says, When my worshipper says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, meaning, praise be to Allah. Normally we would see Lord of the worlds, but I told you Rabb means creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, and curer, and many more meanings in that one word, Rabb. Rabb of the worlds. When my worshipper says, praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Lord of the worlds, I respond saying, my worshipper has praised me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds saying, my worshipper has praised me. This means he hears it, every single one of us, even at the same moment, if we were to say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Allah says, Hamidani Abdi. Look at my worshipper. He has actually praised me. Amazing. Now, do we realize when we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has heard that and He is replying, responding, and He is so happy? Amazing. If we felt that even for a moment, we would take our time in salah. And this is why mostly you find the Imams of the Haram, I know in a lot of other Imams, but I'm giving you that example because I'm sure most of us would know that. Mostly the Imams of the Haram, they would stop at every verse because there is a response. So they would say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. There is a pause. Allah is saying, oh, my worshipper has praised me. Amazing. That's the first verse. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears the worshipper say, most forgiving, most merciful. Some say most beneficent, most merciful. We could say most forgiving, most merciful. Or you could say most merciful, most merciful. Rahman and Rahim are very close in meaning. We will get to that just now, inshallah. So, when a worshipper says Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that hadith, فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ أَرْرَحْمَانِ الرَّحِيمِ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my worshipper has declared my greatness. Imagine, that is the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي, that is the first one. The second response, مَجَّدَنِي عَبْدِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, my worshipper has declared my greatness. Imagine, just by saying Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Those are two verses. The first one, Allah responded. The second one, Allah responded. Maliki yawmiddin, owner of the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my worshipper has declared my greatness. My worshipper has now made mention of a huge fact, and that is the owner of the day of judgment. He is declaring the fact that I am the owner. Allahu Akbar. Another point of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the third verse. There are seven verses in Surah Al-Fatiha. The fourth one, Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. You alone we worship, and you alone we seek help from. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَذَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. This verse is now between me and my worshipper, half-half. And now I will grant him whatever he asks for. Look at the sequence. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will grant him whatever he asks for. Obviously in the hymn, the verb is also included. Please, sisters, don't be offended. Inshallah. It's called taghlib, it's the Arabic language. So, I will grant my worshipper what he or she asks. That is the middle verse of the surah. Why? Because now we are saying, you alone, we worship. You alone, we ask for help. So what is the first dua that is made by us? The most important dua. Because if there was any other dua more important, it would have been mentioned here in this particular surah at this particular juncture. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us to the straight path. That is the most important dua anybody could make. Before you make dua for your Lexus and your Mercedes Benz and your wife and your husband and your house and your debts and your passing of your exams in medical school and what have you. Before that, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us to the straight path. I might die now. You might die now. I don't know if I will walk out of this place, nor do you. If we have been rightly guided, inshallah, we will have whatever we wish. If we haven't been, we won't. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. Meaning the latter. Obviously, I will get into a slight bit of a detail just now. So that is the first dua, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. And that is the only dua. There's no other dua in Surah Al-Fatiha. There's only one dua. Oh Allah, guide me to the straight path. That's it. So every time we are reading salah and we are reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, we are asking for one thing at the beginning, Ya Allah, guide me to the straight path. That's it. Now the description of the straight path follows.
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
The path of those whom you have blessed, whom you have favored, whom you love, whom you have guided. Who are those? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions. And the others whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided, He knows them. Not the path of those who have earned your anger. Why earned your anger? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not just mention who they were? Who were those? Because anyone who earns the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is included in this particular verse. Even though it may be referring to those who knew the scriptures and hid them intentionally because they were fearing to lose numbers to the true submission known as Islam. So anyone who knows the truth and hides it, blocks it, denies it, doesn't want it, throws it aside, is earning the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't want that path, Ya Allah. Save us from that path. And we also want you, Ya Allah, to save us from the path of those who have gone astray. Who has gone astray? Those who are not in search of the truth. Those who have at times known what is right, but their weakness has led them far away. In this particular surah, the Mufassirin have mentioned that there are two groups in particular. Al-Maghdubi alayhim, those who have earned the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Jews. That's what's mentioned in the tafsir. Those Jews that have intentionally covered the truth and blocked it and hidden it and intentionally not shown the others, those are being referred to. But as I said, it does not only include them, it includes anyone who knows the truth and blocks it. Doesn't want the others to know. Themselves, they don't want to practice it. They're included in that. And al-Dallin, those who are astray, the Christians are included in there, according to the Mufassirin, according to the books of Tafsir. But as I've said, it does not only include them, it includes anyone who is astray. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from amongst them. And for this reason, it is very, very important that when we make a dua, we must understand whom we are calling out to and who are we in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator. Who are we? We need to understand that. Let me explain that for a moment. Here you have a Creator who doesn't need me, he doesn't need you. Not at all.
Ya ayyuha an-nas antum al-fuqara.
Absolute need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is independent completely and does not need you at all. There we are. There are many verses in the Quran with similar meaning. So here is a Creator. We are asking Him for something. He's asked us for something as well. We are asking him for something we need. He is asking us for something, but if we were not to fulfill it, he would not really require it from us. He says in the Quran,
وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُوا أَمْثَالَكُمْ.
If you are to turn away, we will come with other nations who will worship us. We don't need you. Others will worship us and they won't be like you. They won't turn away like you. Amazing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us His independence. When we call out to Him with any dua, not only the du'as in Surah Al-Fatiha or the du'a of Surah Al-Fatiha, if you ask Allah, Ya Allah, I want you to help me to pass my examinations. I want you, Ya Allah, to grant me contentment. We want the response when? Immediately. I'm probably writing 5 minutes after I've made the du'a. And I expect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, through His mercy, He will give it. To make me pass, inshallah, He will. I want Him to grant me contentment. Okay, there's a question I have. And this question we all need to ask ourselves. When Allah asked you for something, what did you do? Did you respond? What does He want from you? What does my Creator want from me? What does He want from you? He doesn't need it, but He's told that to us for our own good is required from us. He says, listen, five salah a day. You say, you know, I'm lazy. Yeah, the water's a bit cold. You know, outside, it's slightly cold today. Let me just take a walk that side. We're gone. Does Allah require the salah from us? No, He doesn't. It'll help us. But we're not prepared. Five salah we're not ready to do. Then you make long, big du'as to Allah, expecting Him to respond immediately. Imagine the one whom we need most. We don't want to listen to what He's got to say. And the one who doesn't need us at all, we expect Him to listen to everything that we have to ask. Amazing. Have we ever thought of it? That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, still through my mercy, I give you. Still through my mercy, I give you. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if He were to punish those on earth for their sins, nothing would be left on earth. But it's His mercy that keeps everything flowing and going. We're all weak. We're all trying to earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why the winner is the one who engages in lots of repentance. The hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, and I'm sure a lot of us have heard this hadith. He says, كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّاءَ وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. All mankind are prone to error. They all make mistakes. They all commit sins. Obviously, besides the anbiya, the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who were protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Besides that, Allah says in this hadith, which came to us through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that all mankind commit sins. And the best of those who make mistakes and commit sins are those who often repent to Allah, who often turn to Allah. That means we need to engage in istighfar. And I'd like to bring another point very quickly because it's relevant. When we engage in istighfar, we shouldn't just try and get into the Guinness Book of Records by quickly whipping through the tasbih that we have. Suddenly 100 over and we're gone. Nowadays they've got the new voice recognition. I don't know if you've seen that tasbih. You haven't? Well, I haven't either. I'm just making it up. But it's coming soon, believe me, voice recognition. At the moment I've seen the one where you click it with your thumb. But voice recognition, maybe some of you guys can invent it. You say subhanAllah. If you say it properly, it'll click to the next one. If you don't say it, repeat. I think that would be a good idea, inshallah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us, when you say astaghfirullah, it is such a big act of worship, so huge, that it can render you as pure as the day you were born, as soon as you've said it properly. Amazing. Astaghfirullah means, oh Allah, I'm a criminal, I've committed so many sins, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, I seek Your forgiveness, I repent, Ya Allah, I won't do it again. I acknowledge my crime, my sin. Ya Allah, I won't do it again. That's the meaning of one, astaghfirullah. That's what it means. And Allah says, oh my worshipper, I love you, I've forgiven you completely. You are as pure as the day you were born. One, astaghfirullah. One. Immediately. Just one. Astaghfirullah. May Allah forgive us. But what happens to us? Then again, the issue of concentration. Astaghfirullah. Now, where's the place for the response? Come on. You can't say, hey, how's it? How are you doing? How's everything? How is your exams? How's this? How's that? You can give the man a chance to respond. You know that when it comes to normal language, What about when you're speaking to your own creator? Imagine, you say astaghfirullah, but relax, astaghfirullah. Pause for a moment, think of the depth of your statement and think of the response. It is there, you might not hear it, but it is definitely there. Feel your spirituality move up and then get to the next one. By the time you say astaghfirullah 10 times, 11 times, and you get up from that particular sitting, you will feel rejuvenated inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. Now imagine, getting back to the surah, surah al-Fatiha. We open the verses by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do we say alhamdu? What is the meaning of alhamdu? Alhamdu, the alif and lam, includes all the different types of the item mentioned, the noun that is coming after that. So al, all the types of what? Hamdu, praise. Every praise is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every bit of praise, when you say alhamdu, alhamdulillahi, all praise, every single type of praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means we are thankful to Him for everything He's given us. And we know that He is praiseworthy. We know that He is the one who has granted us absolutely everything. And this is why the word alhamdulillah is not only said in Surah Al-Fatiha, but it is said on a lot of occasions. We know when something happens good, when some good news comes to you, what do you say? Alhamdulillah. You pass, you say alhamdulillah. All praise is due to Allah. So we are opening this salah and we're reading alhamdulillahi. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you're opening salah by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in another place,
La in shakartum la azidan.
If you are thankful, if you are going to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He has given you, He will grant you increase in what He has granted you. And if you are going to be ungrateful, He will take away even that which He has given you, and He may inflict you with a severe punishment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. You know, at this particular university, if you see a person who's very bad to you every day, say for example, you might have given them a lift to come to the university for a week, and after that they began to say bad things about you, they began to backbite, they began, would you give them another lift? You wouldn't, not at all. Trust the youngsters of today, I see the smiles, they probably would do other things to ensure that that person is really fixed, you know, so to speak. I gave the guy a lift, look at what he's doing, you know. I did this for him. You help someone pass the exams, they pass. And the next year they start saying, hey, look at this guy, and so on. Even the smallest of harm to us, we'd feel it immediately. Why? We did good to them. We want to at least have a silent mouth. That's the minimum. Keep quiet. That's the minimum. So with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, you know, if you are thankful and grateful for what I've granted you, I will give you more. The minute you are ungrateful, I will snatch it away and I'll probably inflict you with punishment. May Allah not do that to us. So that is why every rakat of salah, every rak'ah, every segment of the salah, every unit of the salah, we read Surah Al-Fatiha and we start off by saying, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, we thank you for everything you've given us. All praise is due to you, Lord of the worlds, Ya Allah. And He says, oh, my worshipper has actually praised me. That's just the opening verse. Imagine. You really need to think of this. What it implies. What happens. How blessed a moment it is in that particular portion of salah. And we are saying, all praise is due to Allah. We've thanked Him for everything He's granted us. We're acknowledging that He is the owner. And at the same time, we are saying He is the Lord of the worlds. And I told you the meaning of Rabb. What does it include? Creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, and curer, and many more other words. Because the English language does not qualify, sorry, to translate the Arabic language. It doesn't. You need to know the Arabic. It doesn't qualify. I give you an example. Salah. What's the meaning of salah? They say prayer. No, prayer is dua. If you go to a non-Muslim and say, please pray, they'll do this, and they'll pray. Or they depending on the religion, they'll ask something from whoever they believe in. That's a prayer. Salah is not a prayer. Salah is an entire unit a unit made up of words and actions, together with an intention and belief, together with so much spirituality. It starts with an intention and a takbir, and it ends with salam. And it comes in different units. I will write a whole paragraph to translate the one word salam. Amazing. Now you tell me, does the English word prayer really mean salam? We use it just because to make life easy for everyone. We just say, look, it's prayer. We pray five times a day. I pray before I go to the loo. Do you know that? It's true. أعوذ بالله من الخبث والخبائث. I seek Allah's protection from the evil and from the devil and so on, and from the dirt, what have you. That's a prayer, isn't it? We pray before we eat. We do. Bismillah, in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, grant me barakah in the food I'm about to eat. We pray when we've completed eating. Alhamdulillah, الذي أطعمني هذا الطعام ورزقنيه من غير حول مني ولا قوة وسقاني وجعلني من المسلمين. We are asking Allah to digest the food for us. We're praising Him, we're thanking Him, and we're acknowledging that it comes from Him. These are prayers. Now, do we pray five times a day? We pray more than five times a day. But salah, yes, is prescribed five times a day. We'll call it prayer. But the reason I'm mentioning this is to show you that even the word Rabb and so many other words in the Arabic language, they don't just translate as Lord of the worlds. But we are saying, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who made us, the one who grants us, the one who sustains us, the one who cures us, the one who owns us, the one who owns everything around us, the one in whose hands our hearts and our lives are, and so on. That's the opening verse, the most powerful verse of the Quran, the most powerful verse. And when we say Rabb, automatically we are acknowledging that Allah has created us. Automatically, by saying Rabb, we are acknowledging that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us. Now, when you acknowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you, automatically you become the abd. The abd meaning the worshipper. One is a rab and one is an abd. One is the rab, meaning the creator, and one is the worshipper. So by declaring that Allah is your creator, you automatically become Allah's worshipper. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thereafter has revealed the next verse of that particular surah, and he says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. That verse is so powerful, so amazing, so interesting. It consists of only two words. Only two words. Rahmah. They both come from Rahmah. Rahmah meaning mercy. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose to speak about His mercy? Why? Because Islam is a religion based on mercy. Islam is a religion based on mercy. So many people say, Islam is barbaric, Islam is this, Islam is spread by the sword, Islam... That is untrue. That is all propaganda. The largest number of Muslims ever to enter Islam from 1945 to date. Which Islamic wars took place? Not one. Not one. Which sword? Nothing. From September 11 to date, the largest number of Muslims to enter Islam. The fastest growing religion. Which soul? No soul. So why fool the world? Why lie to everybody? There's no soul. People are really learning. They're really looking into it. And on merit, they're accepting it. It makes sense to them. Amazing. Allah. That is why Islam is the most sensible religion. There is nothing hidden. There is nothing in this religion that you're not supposed to know. Nothing. Nothing. If you have a question, ask it. No matter how foolish it may seem in your mind, if you really need to know something, ask him in a polite manner, without being disrespectful. Ask him. You, inshallah, you will be told. There was a time, many years back, when people used to say, hey, don't ask, just read, just do. That era is gone. That is probably, shame, I shouldn't be saying this, but probably because they didn't know the answer, you know. Probably, maybe. There are answers for everything, everything. You want to know, why do I need to make wudu before salah? Why do I have to read salah? Why do we face in a certain direction? Why do I have to be covered from here to there? Why this, why that? There are two things. One is, you will be given the answer, inshallah. At times, the person who's answering you might not be competent enough to give you a solid answer that will be digested immediately through your system, your spiritual system. But you need to understand that there is an answer. You keep on asking until you get that answer, inshallah. You will. Somebody asked me a question about wudu. You know, when I break wind, I wash every place besides that place. What is it? So why do I have to make wudu when I've broken wind? Good question, because it is something absolutely spiritual. It's amrun ta'abbudi. It is something that protects you from the unseen problems and difficulties. And it's something that cleanses you and purifies you and brings you up to another level altogether that you may not comprehend just like that. But get into that condition. Keep yourself in the condition of wudu. See how you feel. Then come back. It's amazing. So these are questions. You can't just say, hey, don't ask. Come on, don't be rude. What's so rude about that? Nothing. We need to know. People need to know. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is mentioning mercy because Islam is based on mercy. He does not say, owner of the severe punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not say, owner of the severe punishment. If he wanted to, he could have. He doesn't mention punishment in this particular surah at all. At all. He doesn't speak about punishment and the wrath and so on. He says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Beautiful verses. Now one might ask, what's the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? Ar-Rahman is also mercy. But that is mercy which encompasses all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muslim, non-Muslim, the animals, the plants, everything. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses all of that through the name Ar-Rahman. So when someone says Abdul Rahman, the worshipper of the most merciful whose mercy, or the worshipper of the most merciful whose mercy encompasses absolutely everything. And Ar-Rahim is a VIP mercy. When I say VIP mercy, I mean it's part of that Rahman, but it's specialized. You have a doctor, for example, a GP, and then you have a specialist. Specialist is more than a GP, I'd like to hope, I'd like to think so. Moments ago I heard somebody saying, we don't attend lectures, and I was thinking, whoa, are those the type of doctors I'm going to go to? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Obviously, it's just on a lighter note. I don't mean to offend anyone. So, the reality is, if you're a specialist, you specialized, that a specialist is obviously going to deal with your hand in a much more professional manner than a GP, though the GP might solve your problem. Obviously this example is totally different, but only to bring it closer to our minds. Ar-Rahman includes everything, but Ar-Rahim is only for the believers. So Allah says there's a special type of mercy that descends on the believers. But yet, there is mercy that descends on everyone, Muslim, non-Muslim, whether they are animals, plants, any other creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all encompassing the mercy. But there is a special type of mercy for the believers. And Allah says in the Quran, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. It is Allah who is Rahim upon the believers. Rahim meaning most merciful of a different, of a specialized nature. Mercy of a specialized nature. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on all of us. So then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of His mercy in these opening verses of Surah Al-Fatiha and the opening Surah of the Quran, which He calls Ummul Kitab. Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book. You know, the Arabic language, they use the word the mother of. I'm sure we all know it because of Saddam Hussein, when he used to say the mother of battles, the mother of battles, the mother of battles, and he kept on saying it until it became the father of all losses. May Allah protect us all. It was actually something very disastrous. We make Allah dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us all, inshallah, and to grant us kindness. But the reason I'm mentioning that is just to show you that in the Arabic language, the word ummun, the word mother, is used to mean something extremely important, something the most important. Ummul Kitab. I'm sure the sisters are smiling. Yeah, very important. That's why it's better to have more children, inshallah. So, so more people can call you mother, isn't it? I mean, come on. One person's calling you mom, mom, mom. You can double that 100% automatically by having another child, inshallah. And you can actually triple it and quadruple it in no time, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make it easy for all the sisters, inshallah. Allah, it's not a joy. It's not a, really, it's very difficult. Motherhood is a gift, and it's a rank that nobody can grant the recompense of besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, it is known as Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book, because the message of the entire Quran is included in this one surah. But in brief, Allah speaks firstly about how praiseworthy He is, how we should be praising Him, how He is the Lord of the worlds. The details are in the rest of the Quran. how that praise is to be, the details are in the rest of the Quran. Then how merciful He is, the details are in the rest of the Quran. Part of His mercy is that He inflicts a little bit of punishment. It's part of mercy. Can I give you an example? Look, you have a child, you love your child to bits and to pieces. Part of that love is, when the child does something wrong, what do? You need to tell them, listen, don't do that. If they do the same thing again, my favorite example, I've given it in a lot of places, let me repeat it here. When a child breaks a glass in the house, you say, oh son, don't worry, we'll buy another one. It's fine. Why? You love your child. Next day, oh dad, broken a glass. Hey son, don't do that. But don't worry, we'll buy another one. Third day, dad, broken a glass. Son, that's not good. Don't do that again. Fourth day, dad, I've broken the glass. Hey, what's your problem? Some might even become a bit physical. May Allah protect us. May Allah make us really, I know the bulk of you probably not married. May Allah grant you spouses who will be the coolness of your eyes. Whoa, I had a loud You know why? It's a dua, really it is. That's the future of the Muslim Ummah. Spouses who will be the coolness of your eyes. Really. And I tell you what, the parenting, especially in the Western world, is not easy. It's quite difficult. It's challenging, really. And may Allah make that easy for you as well. So, this is how we would operate with a child. If a child tells you, you know what, dad, I'm fed up of life and I want to jump off this cliff. What would you do? You would go and say, no, son, don't. You would make sure that physically you lifted the child up and put the child away, even if the child got hurt in the process slightly. That's your mercy. You don't want the child to die. So something that appears negative could actually be positive. Something that appears negative could actually be positive. The same applies with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it wasn't for His warnings of punishment, we would probably choose to go astray. Are you following what I'm saying? If there was no punishment at all, what would we have to be worried about? If there was no register at your lecture halls, why would we go to the lectures? If there were no exams at the end, why? What? You register at De Montfort and inshallah at the end of the term, at the end of the 7 years or what have you, you become a doctor. You're known as Dr. So and so, and that's it. I just registered and paid the fee. And then when the patients come to you, you tell them, be patient. And they say, well, I am a patient, come on. But that's exactly what would happen, because if it was not for a check on us, we probably wouldn't have really been who we are today. But because our parents had rules, regulations, the society, the schools we went to, everyone has rules and regulations. The more rules they have, the better we would probably be as a person. You know, in Zimbabwe, probably the case is the same here as well. The private schools have many more rules and regulations than the public schools. They tell you, you've got to dress in a certain way, you've got to wear your tie in a certain way, you've got to have a blazer hanging in this way, you've got to do this, do that, you've got to play rugby, you've got to play this and that, you've got to have this and all sorts of things. And those private schools, the results are far better, generally, than, you might get the odd few, but generally, than the public schools where people come in casual clothing, they're not bothered how they speak, they can sit, the tables are not in a line, not in order, nothing is orderly, you know, you're just relaxed and you're sitting back, smoking in the classroom and so on, offering the teacher, hey, you want some? And so on. That type of behavior is unruly. You won't develop as a person. So Islam has lots of rules and regulations to make us better. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of His punishment and warns us about it to keep us in line. And that's why the hadith says, Al-Iman bayna al-khawfi wa-raja. True Iman is the right balance between fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment and hope in His mercy. That's the true Iman. If a person has so much hope, they will be astray. And if a person is so worried about the fear, they will never ever live life in accordance to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. So it's the right balance. You need to know we enjoy life within the limits of Islam and we will fear inshallah the punishment. So wherever we've erred, we will turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seeking forgiveness. So Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal decided to have in Surah Al-Fatiha the words of Rahmah and not the words of Adab. There's no Adab mentioned in the Surah. And the Surah is repeated so much to show us that Islam is based on mercy. Meaning these words are repeated, the Surah is repeated, and all this is repeated so many times because of this. Don't we all want the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Well, we ask from Him the mercy and we ask Him to give it to us constantly. There are other religions which say that, you know, Islam is very barbaric and, you know, no forgiveness and so on. And they would claim that, no, we're, you know, fully based on mercy and you can do what you want and so on. All that, sadly, is one-sided. Those who want to speak about Islam should speak fairly. They should balance the statement. Islam is one of the only religions. I know Judaism is quite close in this particular belief, where there is no confession at all to a human being when you've committed a sin. Your sin is your secret between yourself and your Creator. And it can be wiped out immediately. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ.
Some long verses, Allah says, those who have committed immoral acts and those who have oppressed themselves, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately and seek forgiveness. Allah grants them forgiveness and grants them Jannah and paradise in return. Jannah and paradise in return. Another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إِلَّا مَن تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ.
Allah says, those who repent and do good deeds thereafter, they change their lives after repentance. Allah says, we take the sins they've committed and we change them into good deeds and put them onto the right side of the scale. After them having been sinful, they become so good that even the sins then are turned into good deeds. Amazing. That's the mercy of Allah. But the condition for that, two conditions. One is tawbah and changing your life after tawbah. And then another verse, Allah says,
قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا.
Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, O my worshippers who have transgressed against themselves in any way, those who have oppressed themselves in any way, never ever lose hope in the mercy of your Creator, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will forgive every single sin you have committed. He is most forgiving, most merciful. Look at the words, most forgiving, most merciful, repeating themselves elsewhere in the Quran. Didn't I tell you that these words in Surah Al-Fatiha, the details of them are explained in the rest of the Quran. Most merciful. Then we say,
Maliki yawm al-deen.
He is the owner of the day of judgment. What is meant by the owner of the day of judgment? If you are the owner of a place, you can allow people in, or you don't have to allow people in. Or you can make a person feel at home, or you can make them feel unwanted, and so on. You're the owner of something, you can allow a person to use it, to make use of it, or not. You have the discretion. So Allah is the owner of the day of judgment. He is the boss. On the day of Qiyamah, He is always the owner of everything, but on the day of Qiyamah, it will be manifest.
وَخَشَعَتِ الْأَصْوَاتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ فَلَا تَسْمَعُ إِلَّا هَمْسًا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the day of Qiyamah, and He says, all the voices shall be silenced for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's voice, to hear it for His sake and for Him. You will not hear even a pin drop. Meaning you will hear nothing on that day at all. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever He permits, will be allowed to say whatever they have to say. He is the owner of the day of judgment. By saying that, by reading that verse, automatically we are confirming our iman, our belief. What is the difference between iman and Islam? Very interesting and very simple to understand. Islam is generally referring to five pillars, which you can see. They are like actions. You can see. If a person reads the Shahada, can you see that? Yes, you can see. A person reads their Salah, Can you see it? Yes, you can. They're giving zakah. You can see it. They're abstaining from food. You can see it. They're going for hajj. You can see it. Those are the five pillars of Islam. Things you can see. And iman, six pillars of iman, things you cannot see. They're in the heart. You see? Iman. Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawm al akhir wal qadar حلوه ومره أو خيره وشره من الله تعالى. And if we include والبعد بعد الموت, it is also included inshallah in يوم الآخر. You can say six or seven. And I'm sure you know what that means. So by you saying Allah is the owner of the Day of Judgment, you are automatically believing in the Day of Judgment. And by you believing in the Day of Judgment, you automatically believe that you are answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the power of that little verse. We say owner of the Day of Judgment, and in that it's already included that I am answerable to you, Ya Allah. Imagine, declaring the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Declaring His ownership and dominion completely. And Allah responds, He says, oh, my worshipper has declared my greatness. Amazing. So Maliki Yawm al-Din. Now if we believe in the Day of Judgment, there is something we need to know. Every deed we do, every thought we think, everything we see, whatever we do in our lives, we must ask ourselves one question. Do I have a response for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He asks me about this on the Day of Qiyam? That is now true belief in Maliki Yawm al-Din. You say Allah is the owner of the Day of Judgment. Okay, I'm walking out of here. How am I walking? I meet non-Muslims. How do I treat them? Do I act very arrogant? And do I come across extremely rude and so on? Is that the picture of Islam you're meant to be portraying to people who are not Muslims? Is that how you're meant to be attracting them towards your religion? Do you think your religion is only copyrighted or franchised to you? No, it's not. They might accept Islam and become more powerful than me and you. There's a possibility. So we need to beam the message of this particular deen through our actions firstly. The expressions on our face are very important. Sometimes we're sitting in a lecture hall. There is a possibility that the bulk of the people in the lecture hall are not Muslim. And we are Muslim and we're sitting there with a face. Looking corner, this way, that way, you know. What's that? Is that the impression you're meant to be giving to those who don't really know much about Islam? They'll nudge each other and say, terrorists. You know that they use that word for everybody who's a Muslim. Why do we want to give them that opportunity? Wallahi, we're not. And we shouldn't be. So if you really believe that Allah is the owner of the Day of Judgment, you would believe that you are answerable for those expressions on your face to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as small as that. For your income, you are answerable to Allah. Moments ago I told you that there is a hadith which says, the person with the Quran will be told, recite as you used to recite in the dunya, you will continue going up to Jannah until the point you get stuck. I didn't explain to you where you would get stuck. You might be a powerful hafiz. You might know Surah Al-Fatiha solid on that day. That's not what's going to help you. What will help you is, did you practice upon it? Where you deviated, you get stuck. When Allah says, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ, and if you didn't read your salah, then you won't know the verse. Done. So, and أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ is in the first juz of the Qur'an, remember that? So you get stuck in the first part, in the first part of the Qur'an, the first juz. You come, أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. First quarter of the Qur'an. First quarter of the first part of the Qur'an, stuck. Why? Didn't read salah. What about those who used to be judgmental? That's a topic on its own. I've still got to get to it. But those who did not realize that they were answerable to their Creator, where will they get stuck? Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Done. That's where I stop. May Allah protect us. Why? When it comes to Maliki Yawm al-Din, but hang on, you read the verse 1,000,000,000 times. 1 billion, 1 trillion, 1 quadrillion, 1 pentillion, 1 sextillion, 1 septillion, 1 hectillion, 1 nonillion, 1 decillion. I just wanted to show you that I'm Zimbabwean. No, in Zimbabwe, these are the figures because inflation is sitting at 400,000,000%. So every day in the paper, in the newspaper, all these figures I've just given you are actually there. These are real figures. And then they write at the bottom, nobody has ever counted more than 1 decillion. We don't know what is after that. Our currency has gone as far as £1 is equal, I think about 300 sextillion. And that is the figure. I thought it was hex. But they use the word sex. And that's why AIDS is very, very great in Zimbabwe. But anyway, the reality is we repeat this verse so many times, Maliki Yawmiddin, so many times, Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha, we repeat it so many times, but do we actually think about what we're actually saying? Owner of the Day of Judgment, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was making mention of being judgmental. Allah says, He is the owner of the Day of Judgment, nobody else. Why has He kept the Day of Judgment? In order to judge between people and in order to rule on people's hearts. So when I find myself ruling on someone's heart, I haven't believed in the verse correctly. And when you find yourself ruling and judging people's hearts, you haven't believed in the verse correctly. Because Allah says, I have set aside, I am the owner of the Day of Judgment. I've set aside a whole day of judgment to judge people. You sitting on earth and judging people here now? And I'm sure a lot of us become very judgmental and we start saying, oh, this person's like this, that person's like that. Don't judge a book by its cover. Don't. And don't start saying bad things about people. Who knows? They might be better than you. The Quran says that.
عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ
Surah Al-Hujurat, one of the most powerful surahs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the men and the women not to scoff at one another, not to joke and mock and backbite about one another and so on. And in the same surah, He says, look, they might be better than you. That's what I need to believe, that's what you need to believe at all times. That is Maliki Yawmiddin. Allah has kept aside a day to judge. Why must I be judgmental? Be good to people. Worry about yourself. That is why the Quran says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ
O you who believe, be worried about yourselves. Be concerned about yourselves, your weaknesses. Rectify yourself. Those astray will not harm you if you yourself are rightly guided. So worry about yourself. Another verse which that a lot of us know off by heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqullaha wal tanzur nafsum ma qaddamat li ghad.
O you who believe, be conscious of your Creator. And each one of you look into what you have prepared for the day you're going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What have you prepared? Have you prepared any good deeds? Have you prepared any istighfar? Have you engaged in tawbah? Have you had a good heart towards other people? What have you done? You're going to meet your Creator. What have you done to actually earn the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day? And we all know that He says,
فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ
Whoever has done even a mustard seed, or an atom's worth, an atom's weight of good, they'll see it. An atom's weight of bad, they will see it. Unless they engaged in istighfar and tawbah, forgiveness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. That is Maliki Yawmiddin. And then we tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, you alone we worship. You alone we ask for help. And this is a powerful, powerful, powerful verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in complete control of absolutely everything. Whenever we are in need, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever we make dua, the meaning of the word dua, raise your hands and ask, you ask Allah alone. He says it in Surah Al-Fatiha. If you find yourself the other way, this way, that way, then you haven't understood the opening verses of the Quran. Allah says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ You are the only one we render acts of worship to. And you are the only one whom we seek assistance from. What type of help? Obviously, if I'm sitting on a table to eat with you, for example, we're sitting and the ketchup is on the other side, I cannot raise my hands and say, Ya Allah, I need the ketchup. Ya Allah, I need the ketchup. No, that's not what we're talking about. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly shown you with your eyes not that which is connected to the unseen, but that which is physically in front of you, Allah has given a certain person the ability to assist you. You will ask them to help you, they will help you only through Allah's permission. For example, you want a lift to go to Nottingham tomorrow. What would you do? You would have to say, listen brother, are you going to Nottingham? I'd like to come. But you cannot just sit and say, Ya Allah, I need to go to Nottingham. Put it in the hearts of these people to give me a lift. They must come to me, they must tell me. They don't know, I think they look at you and wave as they're going past. You're a fool. Well, I would be a fool if I did that. But let me put myself in the same boat, inshallah. So I would be a fool if I did that. You know the man's got a motor vehicle. You know that you need to get somewhere. You say, Ya Allah, I'm going to approach this person. Put it in their heart to take me. Then you say, listen brother, Salaam Alaikum, how are you? You know what? Are you going to Nottingham? Would you be able to take me? Yes, I would, sure, no problem. Say, Ya Allah, I thank you, Ya Allah. That's the way. You see? So, if physically someone has the capacity to give you something, when I say physically, it removes that which is connected to the unseen. Right? Physically they have the ability to give you something, you can ask them, but you must know the final point, whether they end up giving you or not, is actually in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You play your role, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plays his. Allah has put a role for you to play, like a person who leaves the motor vehicle open. He doesn't lock it. And he says, Tawakkal to Allah. I lay full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he comes back, his vehicle's not there. His vehicle's not there. But what happened? I laid my trust in Allah. The hadith says, I'qilha. Allah told you to play a role and then lay your trust in Him. Without playing your role, you laid your trust in Him. That's not true trust. That is cheating. Literally, that is being foolish. Leave your doors open and say, Ya Allah, let the cold not come here. What are you talking about? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So this is what we remove from, or this is what needs an explanation when it comes to Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'in. But those things connected to the unseen, solely Allah is in control. Ya Allah, cure me. Ya Allah, grant me happiness. Grant me contentment. Nobody besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can grant that to you. It is in the surah. There's no question about it. There's no doubt about it. And the first part of it, Ya Allah, you alone we worship. What is an act of worship? An act of worship is something decreed by Allah, taught to us by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is an act of worship. An act of worship is not something I think of and come up with. No. An act of worship can only be taught by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anything he didn't teach cannot be an act of worship. Like for example, I say, oh, I passed my examinations with distinctions. So I need to thank Allah. I love Him so much. So today, for Dhuhr Salah, I'll make 5 rakats instead of 4. I make 5 rakats instead of 4. Isn't that a brilliant deed? It's a good deed. Salah, what's wrong with it? So at the end of the 4th one, I get up and I say, this is for passing. And I carry on, Alhamdulillah. What am I doing? That is nonsense. You're not allowed to do that. 4 is it. That's it. Why? The Prophet ﷺ never ever stood up for a 5th in that manner, for Salat al-Dhuhr. No ways. So, whenever there is an act of worship, it is determined by the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a deeper understanding of that. Iyyaka na'budu. Ya Allah, we will worship you according to your liking. When you worship Allah how He wants you to worship. You don't just enter the masjid and put your hand up and say, and then walk out of the masjid and say, well, I worshipped Allah, how I felt like. I was so happy. I thought it was a good idea. Brilliant. And then your friends come along and say, yeah, that looks quite good. We'll all do it together. And the next day, everybody looks like a fool doing this. What are you doing? Is that half of the Hitler's greeting or what? So, this is what we mean when we say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself decides how He wants to be worshipped. And we will worship Him accordingly. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. And then I told you the only dua, the most powerful dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Ya Allah, guide us to the straight path. What a beautiful verse. What a powerful verse. If you are guided to the straight path in everything, you'd also pass your exams. Do you know that? Being guided to the straight path in everything means to do that which is correct in everything. So there we are, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Yes, the word الصراط here is referring to a certain path. But all other paths that are correct are included in it. The path of Islam is the first path. That which will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, make us conscious of the fact that you are the one we need to please and help us focus. That's what you're saying. Ya Allah, keep us focused. Imagine, like I always tell the youngsters in the universities in South Africa when I speak to them, did you come here to study? They say, yes. You came here to become a doctor, for example? They'll say, yes. Well, be focused. You didn't come here to get married. Do you know that's a big statement? It's a very big statement. What that means is be focused. Your parents, I know in our case, I don't know about here, your parents have probably spent a lot of money, time, effort. They brought you up. They're spending money to send you to university to become something. You come here and you start messing around with the opposite sex. And that's what's happening. Is that what you're here for? Is that Sirat al-Mustaqim now? Is that being focused in your studies? No, it's not. So when you say, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, it will help you focus and it will keep you content. If only you say it correctly. And you should know why you are here. And ultimately, I should know and you should know why we are in this world. Why I'm in this world. I need to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I need to be focused throughout my life. That look, death is a whisker. And death is something that is not as scary as we think it is. It has to happen to everybody. We have to pass it. We need to prepare for it. We need to be concerned about it. But we cannot be so scared that we actually cling to life. Allah says that those who cling to life, in fact, He has described them as with a negative description in the Quran. He has described them with a negative description in the Quran. Because we all know we're heading in one direction. We start graying and then we get to the next stage, we get children. Soon our children will also go to through the educational systems and so on. And the cycle continues. We will die and 150 years later, maximum 150 years later, nobody will know us. Can you tell me, can you name 5 people in your community who lived 150 years ago? The answer is no, generally, unless you're a genius. In your community, 5 people 150 years ago? Nah. Allahu Akbar. So 150 years after I die, you die, would they know me? You? Who sat in this hall when it was built? Name me 10 people? No, I can't. Amazing. And we think we are it, IT. MashaAllah. We are it. There's a chocolate that I see, it's called it. It says, only eat it if you are it. SubhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. This is the new type of advert in the world. They're trying to make everyone feel, you know, I'm the boss, I'm it, you know. And if you're it, amazing. IT stands for something else as well. But the reality is we need to be focused, inshallah. And this is what Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim is all about, focusing on the right path. And as I said, whenever we are astray, whenever we find ourselves on the wrong side of the law, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, always engage in tawbah. Remember, and I want to make this one of the final statements that I'd like to end with. Every single one of you is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what you've done, Allah loves you. That's one thing you need to know, you need to take back with you today. No matter what you have done, including the sisters who are here, Allah loves you. That's a fact. That's why we're seated here today. And we need to go away with something. Allah loves us so much. He knows that deep down we all want to be good, don't we? He knows deep down we all want Him to be happy with us, don't we? He knows deep down that some of us are struggling a little bit more than others to get closer to Him. He knows it. But the reality is, get up and do something. Get up and be positive. Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Don't allow yourselves to get caught in the clutches of shaitan. Release yourself from the shackles of shaitan and you'll find the spirituality moving at its pace, beautifully. And you will feel so good about it. And remember, salah is the most important aspect in my life and your lives. Obviously, after the iman and all that, salah. Salah will help you to focus. And when it comes to the sisters, one of the most important things you can sacrifice is your dress. For a sister to dress appropriately is one of the biggest struggles. And it is one of the hugest achievements. And it is done for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine, the hadith says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes so happy that he boasts to the angels to say, look at that worshipper of mine. They're doing it solely for me. You know, when you love someone to bits and pieces, I'm sure you do a lot for them. So much so that if they told you jump, you jump. Keep on jumping until I come back, half an hour later. Why? Because you love them. It's a fact. That's a mere mortal that you're jumping for. What about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this person, if they see you jumping half an hour later, they say, oh, shame, you know. Oh, look at you, poor thing, you know. And they pass so many comments and they tell, oh, this guy jumped for me for half an hour, you know. Those are mere mortals. I hope nobody tells anybody to jump for half an hour, please. These are mere mortals. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, dress appropriately. If you know it's a battle, you know people are going to laugh at you, you know people are going to pass comments, you know you're going to be sidelined slightly this way, that way, people will say things, and you're doing it, ya Allah, solely for your sake, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be so pleased with you. Amazing. Don't you want to try that, inshallah? And remember, there are always levels. You got to one level, you can get to the next, and the next, and the next. And inshallah, these are levels that we can all get to without looking down upon someone who might physically appear to be seemingly on a lower level. They might be on a higher level inside. So, I spoke about salah, very important. Because at the beginning of this talk, I told you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ, I have divided salah into two. He refers to Surah Al-Fatiha as salah. One of the names of Surah Al-Fatiha is As-Salah. One of the names of the surah is As-Salah. And one of the reasons the scholars have given is because it is repeated in every salah, in every unit of every rak'ah, meaning of every salah. It's repeated. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have divided the salah and I will give him what he wants. I will give my worshipper what he wants. What do we all want? We want to be focused. When you are focused, you'll get contentment. When you are content, inshallah, you will get everything else. Your health will be in order. You will be a happy person. When you are happy, inshallah, you will be saved from so many calamities. When something good happens, you thank Allah. When something bad happens, you are patient. And so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding, inshallah. Obviously, this is a surah. I have tried to explain it without getting extremely technical. And at the same time, tried to keep it a little bit lively, bearing in mind the age group that we're speaking to. And at the same time, I hope we have understood the meaning, at least, of Surah Al-Fatiha, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has really kept so much meaning in this short surah with seven verses in it. And to end with, I'd like to say a point of encouragement for myself and yourselves. Read the Quran and understand it. And read the English of the Quran as well as the Arabic of the Quran. Sometimes people ask you, what should we do? The answer is, you should read the Arabic as well. For every letter you get 10 rewards. And you should read the English as well, because it is haram to neglect the meaning of the Quran. The Quran says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Are they not going to try and understand the Quran? What's the answer? Ya Allah, we will. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ. That verse has two meanings. We have made this Quran so simple to memorize. Is there anyone from amongst you who is ready to do that? First meaning. The second meaning. We have made this Quran so simple to understand. Is there anyone from amongst you who is going to attempt to understand it? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who will try to understand the Quran. And I'm sure we all intend, inshallah, to try and understand the Quran. Is that the case? Wallahi, it's a powerful book. Sometimes you sit and you ask people, how many books have you read? And they say, well, about 65, 70 books. Have you read the Quran? No, I haven't. But why? You've read novels of so and so and so and so, I don't even know the names. Or should I say, maybe I know them, but I don't want to say them. And you haven't read the book of Allah, the book of your Creator, the book, the most powerful book, the book that turned the kuffar of Makkah by reading one or two verses? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And remember, those people, a lot of them were unlettered. Unlettered meaning ummi. They were unable to read or write, most of them. They heard one or two verses and it shook them and changed their whole lives, and they entered the fold of Islam. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, do you know which verses he heard?
He was an enemy of Islam who went out to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he read the verses,
Taha ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'an litashqa illa tadhkiratan liman yakhsha.
He began to tremble, he began to cry, and he said, take me to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his life changed by reading not more than the first four verses of Surah Taha. With us, we read the Quran from cover to cover, and we open it again, and we read it from cover to cover. We call it a khatam. So we make one khatam, two khatam, 10 khatams, and our lives haven't changed. We haven't left the sins we were in. We haven't even flinched an eyelid, nor have we even allowed our heart to even think that we've read the book of the owner of entire creation. Amazing. Why? Because we haven't even attempted to understand it. If we were to try to understand the Quran, wallahi, we would cry, we would weep. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand the importance of going into the Quran and the meanings of the Quran. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.